This is the time, this is the place, and this is FC3 Monkey Business, your one-stop shop for everything geeky. And since everything is geeky, if you love it enough, you never know what you're going to get. This is your host, I am C. In the studio with me, as always, is the ever-legendary Billy DeTore.
Hello.
Tanya Metris.
Hello.
And on the phone with us, producer Sherry and producer Chris. Good to hear from you guys.
Hello.
We have special guests today. Young Tyler Metris.
Hello.
And today we're going to be talking about the 1990 film The Mummy with Brendan Fraser, Rachel Weisz, and FC3 future guest Erick Avari.
Woohoo!
After that, stick around for our upcoming events and our question of the week. How are we doing, gang?
I'm tired today.
Yeah, I'm feeling, you know, the weather roller coaster is pushing everybody out over the brink again. But you had those two really gorgeous days, and then it dipped back into gray and rainy. It's sunny today, but it's cold, and I think it's just the roller coaster's throwing everybody off.
Well, when I came in here today,
snowing here.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. I was going to say.
When I came in here to do some work this morning, it was rainy and snow, like a combination of rain and
like
snow.
Little flurries, yeah.
And my feet got wet, my socks got wet, and I hate when my feet get
that
wet.
Would,
so.
See,
need
that
the heater?
Would end my day right there. Yeah. That would end my day.
You should have just turned the heater around to your feet, Billy.
Yeah. I don't want to set anything on fire with that thing.
Well, maybe if it's turned down low. Yeah. I don't know.
So,
but yeah, you seem kind of blah today.
Yeah,
it's everybody's entitled to an off day.
Last
I don't
night, I watched an awful baseball game for a little while.
Okay.
Then I watched a movie I didn't like, but I think you guys did. So we'll get into that.
And you like a different version of it.
Yeah. Well. Yeah.
Don't you?
Yeah, but yeah. I would have liked this one if I thought it was good.
You know what? That's going to be a valuable opinion today.
Okay.
That's going to be a valuable opinion today.
I have just gotten a notification. Our friend Sybil is having issues with her phone today.
Okay.
She said to go on without her. She's going into Verizon to get it figured out.
All right.
Go on without me.
Yes.
No.
Oh, we're going to miss her.
We miss the Sybil. All right. So that's a thing. Anything new, Chris and Sherry?
Well, other than the fact that it is actually snowing, and as of this taping, it is April 29th, which is not making me happy.
Angie's fault.
Yeah, I blame her.
I'm blaming Angie.
I always blame Angie.
That's okay. Hopefully she got her soul ripped out yesterday.
There you go. Infinity War has hit theaters.
Oh, man. I'm trying to figure out why her son does not like it.
Well, I think he's just trying to get a rise out of somebody, really.
Oh, okay.
Because Ray, who has been on the show, posted his initial review is it was 1,000% trash and he hated it.
And so therefore, he's just opening a whole can of whoop-ass.
He's opened up a can of big can of whoop-ass.
We'll talk about that.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that.
No spoilers. No I haven't seen it
Billy
yet.
Billy hasn't seen it.
Tyler? I can't even make I think basically my feeling. The only thing I can really say is the same
again.
Thing. I have to see it again. And the same thing that I said at the end of Last Jedi is, what did I just watch?
It's like, you know? Man.
All right. So, guys, I'm no longer house hunting.
You bought a house.
I bought a house. It happened. Finally happened. So that's a thing. That long...
Tyler's clapping for
that
you.
That long ordeal is over with. I'll close most likely in July.
You have to get through the show first.
Yeah, they're like, well, we can, you know, because... The people who are selling wanted some time to do, and the people who are buying, such as myself, want some time to get a few things done. So we're like, okay, July, that can happen. And the mortgage broker calls me up. She goes, we can do this the second weekend of June. I'm like, I'm already busy the second weekend of June.
Yep.
Oh.
One major event a year, please, or a month, please. So
and remember, if you buy four houses, you can buy a hotel.
That's my plan now. That's if I can get three more. If I get three more, then I should be able to buy the Radisson.
Like a grenade.
Just remember to cross go, get $200.
We are going to have to do a special countdown post today on our Facebook page.
Is today the 40?
40 days, 21 hours, 27 minutes, 48 right. seconds, 47, 46.
So we can launch we can launch the 40 today then, is what you're saying.
Yes, we'll be launching the 40.
Sherry gave me some great
for
graphics.
What?
For 40 days to
the convention.
It was a joke, guys.
Oh.
Wow.
Wow.
Sherry can attest my sense of humor is a little dented right now today. All right.
Pretty much.
Oh.
Yeah. So let's do some sponsor shout outs. We've got a lot of the usual suspects. Knox Craft Cocktails and Comfort Food, located in the Village Gate. Selena's Mexican Restaurant, the Great Escape Room. The Sherlock Holmes-themed escape adventure.
Which we still have to go play in the library.
Yes, we haven't rescued Billy.
We got to put Billy back in the library and rescue him. Tyler says he's going to rescue him.
I see. Yep. Single-handedly? I want to see that. Wibbly Wobbly Timey Wimey is bringing us Caitlin Blackwood, the young Amelia Pond. Pop Rock Comics and Caffeine and Culture, the new business on East Avenue with Jason Hilton there leading that charge. And Redfin Realty. So two of the new folks. Pop Rocks and Redfin. Thank you guys for coming on board. Patreon. What is Patreon? Patreon is a membership platform that makes it easy for you to support Monkey Business and Flower City Comic Con. Please check us out at www.patreon.com/FC3ROC. All membership levels will include access to the Patreon-only blog, plus tons of great perks at all levels. Patreon spelled P-A-T-R-E-O-N. Spell it now on your web browser. Go there. Sponsor us. You'll love it. It'll be great. I promise it'll be the best thing ever. It's tremendous. Wait a minute. Never mind. I'm doing an impression now. Apple Podcasts. Want to help others find the show? Leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. Every review will be thanked on the air, and any questions will be answered. We want this to be a conversation, so please send us your questions. In addition to Apple Podcasts, you can now find us on Google Play Music and Stitcher. Is there a place you find your podcast and you can't find FC3 Monkey Business? Let us know, and we will see what we can do to join in on that platform. All right, so that's cool, all the business.
Cool.
Do you got stuff?
So.
Do you have anything? You look like you want to say something.
Nope, I'm just reading right along with
you're
you. I actually have the taping notes on.
I'm on script today.
I know you are.
For a change of pace.
Because I actually opened my email instead of trying to read it from my phone type thing. So.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, the 1999 hit movie, The Mummy, starring Brendan Fraser and Rachel Weisz. The movie that Billy was not as thrilled with. And I'll tell you what, I'm almost there with him, I think. So we'll talk about that more in a little bit.
Yeah, and I'll leave you with a little buddy guy. Appropriate, 40 Days and 40 Nights.
Nice.
Radio 95.1.
Love it.
It's not Radio 95.1.
It's just Force of Habit.
I stink.
No, you don't. The Mummy is a 1999 American action fantasy film written and directed by Stephen Sommers, starring Brendan Fraser, Rachel Weisz, John Hannah, Kevin O'Connor, and Arnold Avoslu in the titular role as the reanimated mummy. Yeah, I can speak good today. It is a loose remake of the 1932 film The Mummy, which starred Boris Karloff in the titular role. In this film, an English librarian named Evelyn Carnahan becomes interested in starting an archaeological dig at the ancient city of Hamunaptra. I tried that a couple of times before.
Hamunaptra?
Hamunaptra. And she gains the help of Rick O'Connell after saving him from his death by execution. What Evelyn, her brother Jonathan, and Rick are unaware of is that another group of explorers are interested in the same dig. Unfortunately for everyone, this group ends up unleashing a curse because, you know, Americans, we do that.
Yeah, well.
Which a curse which had been laid on the dead high priest Imhotep. Now the mummy is awake and is going to take a lot more than guns to send him back to where he came from.
It's going to take a whole group of adventurers and magic and everything.
There you go.
Like,
see?
I was talking last night when watching it going, wow, this is like all of our D&D groups like put
wildest
together.
Wildest dreams.
Yes.
Yeah, it's
Just the treasure room.
I actually did use this movie as a basis of an adventure that I wrote many years ago.
I'm glad I wasn't there.
Yeah, it was a total party kill. Everybody set off every freaking trap in a row, and then the mummy just ate who was left. It was amazing. So, All right. Now, right off the bat, what did we think of this movie? Sherry, Chris, what did you guys, did you watch it recently?
Yeah, we watched it last night.
Last night. That seemed to be a popular thing on staff. All right. Right off the bat, what did you think of it?
I really like this movie.
Okay.
I really do. I like the second one better.
Really?
Yes, I do. I do like the second one better. I like how Evelyn grows in the second one. I like their smart alecky kid in the second one. Mm-hmm. I really did like the second one better, but I do like this. We own the Mummy collection.
Okay.
So
I don't think I ever saw the third one that had Maria Bello in the Evelyn part, and then I definitely did not see the Tom Cruise one.
I didn't see the Tom Cruise one, but we have the third one where they're going into like the Dragon Emperor tomb.
Okay. Yeah, I haven't seen that one.
We actually have that one.
All right.
So I'm the only one that owns the collection of the Universal Monster ones from
the
30s.
The actual classics.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
The real monster movies.
Yes.
I've been thinking about this since I watched it yesterday. I'm okay with this movie. I remember loving it before, but I'm like, you know, there's a lot of funny stuff. There's a lot of great one-liners in this movie. And I think the action's good. There's definitely some back and forth. It's early years of the CGI, so the CGI looks like it holds up over the years.
Absolutely.
You know,
that was one thing I was impressed with last night.
Yeah.
Was how good it looks still.
Right. And the visuals. And I like, I mean, Oded Ferrer, who played the Magi? The Chief Magi.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Character actor. He's been in a ton of things now.
Hold on.
You see him in Resident Evil 2 in series.
Yeah. You got it right. Oded.
Oded Ferrer. I think he's phenomenal. Yeah. I love the guy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But here's it. I'm sitting here and we want to talk about it. And I just want to say, but, you know, it's like there's something wrong. And I, you know what it is? I finally put my finger on it while I was warming up to say, but it was one of those movies that should never have been a franchise.
I
disagree with Sherry. There should not have been a second movie. There should definitely not have been a third. And to remake it with Tom Cruise was just an error. I think as a standalone movie, it worked. Yes, it's great. In the second one, you see Evelyn's evolution. Good. That's okay. But the smart alecky kid, but he blew it for me. Because what
I like him.
Kids and puppies. You charm a certain level of the audience, but then I think the story will suffer to accommodate the kids and the puppies. All right? You know, you see that on several occasions. So this is where my butt lies into. It should, if I'm going to, you know, if we ever get around to talking about Highlander, I'm going to say the same thing. There should have been only one.
There can only be one.
There can only, you know, that can be only one. But with The Mummy, this was a good standalone story when you, they got the gold, he got the girl, the good guys survived, the bad guys got eaten, literally, and, you know, moving on into the sunset, they moved on into the sunset at the end of the movie. Should have left it at that. I think that's what, I really do, I think that's what caught, it's my problem with this movie, is that there was a sequel.
My problem so much isn't that there was a sequel,
uh-huh,
but it was the same movie.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, like, right, you know, I mean, we can pick apart the
same characters.
Yeah.
You know, yes, you get Scorpion King in there,
uh-huh,
but.
Well, the chase scene with an airship.
It was,
you know,
a lot of the same movie.
It was just reskinned a little bit in certain spots. So I think that's kind of, now, that's not fair to the first movie because, you know, I don't even know if they were planning a sequel when they made the first movie. But anyway, so that's that. And there's a lot of good trivia because Sherry finds awesome trivia. Let's see. What's a good piece of trivia here we can jump in with?
Start right at the top.
Well,
right at the
top. My favorite piece of trivia is actually about Evelyn, the character of Evelyn, how she got her name.
Okay, go with it.
She was actually, her name came from, it was a slight reworking of the daughter of the man who found King Tut's tomb.
Oh, cool. Okay.
And originally, the character was supposed to be her,
mm-hmm,
but then they decided not to go with that. But it still lives on when she says that her father was a very, very famous archaeologist.
That's cool. Yes, okay, I did pick up on that. Okay, so that's a nice little tip of the hat to history there.
Yeah.
Imhotep was actually the name of the architect who developed the first pyramids in ancient Egypt, most notably the pyramid of Djoser. I don't know, I can't pronounce Egyptian words sometimes, at Saqqara, around 2600 BC. His ability was such that he was later said to have descended from the gods. His name means one who comes in peace. However, as far as anyone knows, he was not a despised villain as portrayed in the movie, much more likely revered as the architect and physician that he was. So again, it's a little creative liberty with some writing there. So we're going to not a book this. Let's jump in from the beginning. The opening scene. I think my favorite part of the opening scene is Patricia Velasquez's costume, or lack thereof.
Wow. Took 4 hours to apply that.
That body, it's basically a loincloth and body paint.
That's what it is.
That's
probably
it.
Probably did.
And few pieces of jewelry.
Yeah.
Yep, that's body paint.
Yeah. And this was the first time I ever saw Patricia Velasquez on screen. And it made me a fan instantly. I'll just say that right now. yeah, you guys are not helping me out at all.
She was such a fine actress in this film. I can see why you would love her.
What's that?
Because she was such a fine actress in this film. I can see why you love her.
Oh, I know. She had such a presence. She had a pair of presences in this film. That scene, did it do a good job of setting up what was going to happen in the movie? Kind of give you that little enough backstory in that brief couple of minutes.
Sort of like that because it's a quick origin story. Here's how things started. There you go.
They're having an affair. Yeah. They kill the pharaoh, and then they're cursed.
They're cursed.
I'm glad they didn't spend 2 hours with that story, which a lot of movies nowadays would have.
They have been. Like the Fantastic Four movie was a 110-minute trailer for the movie we wanted to see.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's that you kind of do the jumping into the action with that brief, just little look at ancient Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then go ahead.
Sorry, the mummification scene, if you could call it a mummification scene with Arnold Vosloo.
Uh huh.
I guess that took 4 hours. And he had a real problem with being wrapped up like that for 4 hours.
Said that he was freaking out in it. In your...
So Imhotep's rage and emotion is there getting ready to put the lid on while he's squirming around in the bandages. He's drawing on a little bit more natural reaction.
Oh, that says the scene? Yeah. 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 That where Imhotep is mummified, freaked out the actor. He had to be in bandages, as Sherry said, for 4 hours to film those scenes where he's wrapped and put in the tomb.
Well, at least they weren't real bugs.
A lot of them, down further in the notes, where was it? It says, while the film made extensive use of the computer-generated imagery, many scenes, including the ones where Evelyn is covered with rats and locusts, were real using live animals.
Wow.
I'm done.
Why?
I had problems with the scarab beetles throughout the whole thing.
Oh, I know.
I was burying my face the entire time. I can't handle that in regards to the
I wouldn't like that.
Yeah, so.
Tanya and I watched the movie together yesterday. And whenever she knew the scarab scenes were coming, the head would get turned, blankets would get pulled up over her eye, and then I would hear, "Can you just tell me when it's done?" You'll know it's done when the sound goes away.
I know, that's even worse. It's like my eyes need to be covered and my ears need to be covered. I was talking to Deanna on my way home going, that's like the worst part of the movie. I'm like, I can handle everything else except for the bugs.
Yeah, I don't like bugs. I don't like rats. I don't like creepy crawly things.
Uh-huh.
But so that stuff grosses me out. My biggest problem with the movie, I think, is that I never understood Brendan Fraser. I'm sure he's a nice fella, but I can't. To me, he's a forgettable actor.
Okay.
I went into this movie. I borrowed it from the library, took it home last night. I'm going to watch it. And it turns out, I think I've seen it before. Mm-hmm. And that when we got to the, I guess, second scene where Rachel Weisz is on the ladder in the library.
Mm-hmm.
I go, wait a second. Does she knock everything over? I've seen this.
Yeah.
But you saw that coming anyway.
Yeah, sure. But I knew exactly what was going to happen. And like flashes of this movie came to me as they happened. Like, I have seen this, but I couldn't tell you Brendan Fraser's character's name right now for $1 million.
So Rick O'Connell.
Yes. Hey, Benny.
So I guess let me try to see if I sum that up. So you're saying he's a forgettable leading man?
Yes. He is what Tom Hanks would have been if he kept making Volunteers and Turner and Hooch and movies like that instead of Apollo 13 and
Forrest Gump.
Exactly.
Philadelphia.
I haven't liked a Brendan Fraser movie.
Okay. And he disappeared for a while. Tanya and I were talking about this mm-hmm. yesterday, and I think we're kind of supposing or assuming mm-hmm. what some of those issues were, but he just disappeared.
He's in a TV show now or something. I looked him up now, too, to see what he's up to.
Yeah.
But I'm sure he's a good guy, and, mm-hmm. you know, he made a career, and good for him, and I don't like anything he's in, pretty much.
Yeah.
Yeah, so. He did a YouTube thing in February revealing why he disappeared from Hollywood.
Okay.
Because of me?
Yeah.
Well, Billy, I'm sorry.
He does. It's top 10. I'm looking at the list right now. Yeah. He's first, number one, Billy DeTore. Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe not.
Billy's opinion of me. That's what.
So, like I said, there was some decent action. The effects do still hold up, mm-hmm. for real.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I just... Maybe I was just in a lousy mood because I turned off the baseball game I was watching with my team losing 6-0. I turned it back on. It was 11-2.
Oh, boy.
All right. But I guess it was a forgettable movie.
Okay. All right. Tyler, did you watch it yet?
I've watched all three of them.
Yeah? And what'd you think of the first one? Because that's the one we're talking about right now. What makes you say, Can you give me something?
He hasn't watched it recently.
So?
I haven't.
No? Well, if you're going to sit the microphone, you got to be able to
contribute. See, told you, forgettable.
That's it. You about to say something, T, I think.
In regards to Tyler, he sits there and just enjoys the movie, and then he'll mm-hmm. like try to figure out the commentary
okay.
in regards to something particular. And uh-huh. it's like, it takes him a little while. It's like, give him about another 5-10 minutes. He'll say, this is the reason why.
Okay.
Type thing. Give him some processing time. He'll do it. I mean, I just sat back and just enjoyed it for the enjoyment value. I don't need the follow-up of the second and the third movie. Yeah, I'll watch them again or whatever. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I'm not necessarily going to like it as the first one. It's just like when you watch, like, Grease or whatever, mm-hmm. that you don't want, like, they have made Grease 2 and you're like, why? Mm-hmm. Type thing. So,
well, because it made Adrian's Met a star.
So sometimes I'm like,
who?
Yeah. People love it, or they're just okay with it.
Made Michelle Pfeiffer. Star.
There you go. There's.
But it's funny because when we were watching it yesterday, when he was in the jail in Egypt, the first thing I looked at, I'm like, that's a throwback to him in Encino Man. With his hair all shaggy and things down there.
Why does he have a 90s haircut in 1932?
I don't know.
Or 1923 or whenever that
because
movie.
Because this was done in 1999?
Yeah, but he should look more like Laurel and Hardy and less like, you know, Brendan Fraser.
Yeah, so I don't know. So it's Hollywood's depiction of that?
I'm sorry.
Like, I don't know.
I'll go to my corner.
Well, here's the thing is when they introduce the first, you know, they go from the flashback scene to give you the basis of the movie. The next scene is in the library. So you see Evelyn doing her stilt walk on the ladder mm-hmm. and knocking mm-hmm. over bookshelves. Okay, so that's you're establishing that character, and
real reason why we watch The Mummy comes in right after that scene.
Erick Avari, and his, you know, is he should have had more screen time.
He should have.
He really should have. That was a very cool character.
You know,
to watch.
Initially when I was watching, I'm like, oh, okay, we just see him in the library. And I forget that he comes back, reoccurring a couple times uh-huh. throughout this, and I'm like. Oh, yeah. I'm like, wait, wasn't he a bad guy? No, wait. Because that was like the first thing. I'm like, wait, wasn't he one of the other bad guys? And then I realized that he's one of the Magi.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm. Now, John Hannah as the brother.
Oh, my God.
I liked the character. I like John Hannah. I see him in a lot of things. My favorite John Hannah performance is always going to be Four Weddings and a Funeral. The Hugh Grant movie. But John Hannah was also in, what was that one about ancient Rome? Spartacus, with Lucy Lawless playing his wife. I like John Hannah.
Isn't he a zookeeper at the Columbus Zoo?
I don't know. That's Jack Hannah.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
I watch him every Saturday morning. Hell with it being a kid's show. I'm parked in front of the TV for Jack Hannah.
I like him.
Jack Hannah's a fun show. He knows what to do around stingrays is stay away from him. But anyway. I didn't like the brother character. It was like he needed He was going out of his way to be the bumbling idiot.
The comic relief.
Yeah, yeah,
he was going out of his way to be the comic
he
relief.
He was Kramer in The Mummy.
Everybody had a chance to say one-liners. Everybody had an opportunity to be in that moment where they could be funny unintentionally. You know, like, I think just an observation or whatnot. Even Oded Ferrer's character managed to kind of, like, you know, he had that look in his face on a couple of occasions, or he would have the right comment to make that was just out of, you know. So the whole movie had some good humor all the way through it. To have John Hannock bumbling his way through it and making mistakes and, you know, going out of his way to do it, I was like, oh, come on. Can we just tone this guy back a little bit, please? I don't, am I the only one in that opinion?
No.
I like him. I like the character. Uh-huh. I like the actor.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm not trying to shade the actor, because like I said, I like John Hannah. There's a lot of work that he's done that's just unquestionably good. But just this one particular character, it was overly silly when he didn't need to be. But, so that's it. I'm going to fall flat. Nobody else is going to say that's it.
That's it.
I always liked Jonathan. I thought he was a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. I thought he was a bit of levity when things were getting a little crazy. Yeah, he could be silly, but I didn't think he was cartoonish.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Was he this movie's version of Short Round?
There you go. I'll go with that. Hang on, lady, we're going for a ride.
Dr. Jones, I touched nothing.
See, there you go. Yeah. It takes him a little while to come in. No, I mean, I enjoyed him in the movie. I'm mm-hmm. I don't think he is like the four that are memorable are him, Benny, Rick,
mm-hmm.
and Rachel.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the mummy.
Mm-hmm.
But they all have their part to play in order to kind of balance each other out during this type thing, because he's always drunk and getting himself into trouble, and his, mm-hmm. his sister's like, oh my God, what did you do this time type
yeah.
thing. And so I think that just shows the dynamic of everything that she's had to put up with him. And mm-hmm. he's smart and he's intelligent, but yet he's still kind of a goofball at point. And mm-hmm. then he ends up having to save her at the end type thing. So
right.
he kind of like grows as the movie goes on.
Okay.
So.
All right.
That's my take on it.
Okay. Well, then we are introduced to the siblings and then introduced to our FC3 guest, Erick Avari, his character, who makes it very clear that he finds Evelyn to be an unmitigated disaster on high heels.
A catastrophe.
A catastrophe
she's
is what he calls
her. She's not an accident. She's a catastrophe.
That's right. That was the line. And then we move on to re-meeting Rick O'Connell, who is the trope of finding your hero, you know, and rescuing him from like I don't know. There's a point that I want to make, and I can't find the way to get to it at the moment. It's
this one's like really stumping you.
There's a trope there, of how they find, like, Rick setting up Rick.
Is it a meet cute?
What
is it, a meet cute?
I don't understand what that is.
It's a movie term for when two characters meet each other uh-huh. as a couple in like an unusual circumstance.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. And I'm wondering if they forced that a little bit, mm-hmm. you know, with him being in the prison there in Egypt and sentenced to death. And they were really kind of like glossing mm-hmm. that over. You know, like was what did he do to get that far into the shit there? And how bad was it really? You know, and then the warden was like, oh, okay, no problem. Yeah, go ahead, save him. And I'm coming along, and it'll be fine. We'll be a team. It'll be great. It'll, you know, be a little adventuring team together. It's like, wait. There was just something all about that prison scene that was like, wait, what's going on here?
To an earlier scene that I questioned,
yes.
and maybe it's just because I was in a bad mood. Beginning of the movie, mm-hmm. The pharaoh is killed by the guy that was having the affair with the hot lady.
Right.
Why didn't the pharaoh's guards like imprison him and kill him right then instead of they went on an adventure to bury I lost track of this already.
Okay.
But
why make it so complicated?
Yeah.
Why not just kill him right there on the spot
yeah.
for killing the pharaoh?
Exactly.
Take
him to jail. Why did they follow him to the desert? And
the reason was is that when, which I believe it's shown more clearly in the second one.
Mm-hmm.
When they took him prisoner, his priests broke him away from them, and they escaped to the desert. That's why his priests were also cursed.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Right. Yeah, because they stole her body to take into the
gotcha.
Desert in order, but they broke him out of
okay.
jail, because I think they did put him in prison. They broke him out of jail.
Mm-hmm.
Raced to the desert, and then the Pharaoh's guards had followed them.
Oh, okay.
And that's
I'm
why
sorry
they were
to
all
drag us back.
That happened
no, that's okay.
so quickly
a...
that it, no, that's fine.
Right,
that it happened so quickly. It's like, wait a second. As soon as you started questioning it, Billy, I'm like, yeah, you know, he might have a point there. And then Sherry cleared it up. I'm like, okay.
So it's a matter of like, did you look away from the TV during that time? Because yeah, you would miss it
mm-hmm.
type
mm-hmm.
thing. But then I think it was explained in
Mummy 2.
Well, that, but maybe when they were talking with
and then they froze him in carbonite.
Yeah. And sold him off to Jabba the Hutt.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Are you sure this is not Side Quests and Digressions?
Oh, that's later.
Yeah.
That's
wrong
so later.
Movie.
I heard a lot of whispering at the other end of the phone. Do you guys have something that we're missing?
No, it was actually me messing with the mic.
How's it coming along over there?
I don't know. How do we sound?
You sound pretty
good.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot.
They're good.
Definitely a lot better. Did you get the headset that you were looking for?
Yeah.
Coolness.
Yep.
Coolness.
And they're not that expensive, so I think anybody who calls in should get one.
There you go.
$10.
$10?
$10.
All right. Let's find some more trivia to play with. Ooh. Hang on a second here. Oh, I hit the microphone. That was me.
What was really interesting when I was looking through the trivia was finding out that this was an early... really well done use of motion capture.
Really?
That they really didn't want, the director really didn't want the mummy to be shambling and everything, so they used motion capture
mm-hmm.
to make him, so that they could make him move like a real person. And they also used a lot of, it's an early use of putting lights on someone to show, to then be able to add things later on, which is why his effects on Arnold Vosloo's face are so good.
Okay.
Because that was actually him, but he said that he was walking around with these red lights attached to his face. He said he looked like a Christmas tree.
So they had the pinpoints to be able to do the CGI more effectively.
Yes.
Okay. That's cool.
So this is an early use of that, which I thought was really interesting.
So Arnold Vosloo was the original Andy Serkis.
Kind of, yeah.
Gotcha. And Andy's really taken motion capture acting to a whole new level over the years. Rachel Weisz was not a big fan of horror movies. But did not see this film as such. She said in an interview, it's Hokum, a comic book world. Is that kind of maybe why you're not having as much fun with this one, Billy? Is that
maybe I was in the wrong mood for it, but like I said, mm-hmm. I think my brain seems to think I've seen it before.
Okay.
And normally I don't have a problem separating fantasy from, you know, a more realistic type movie.
Uh-huh.
And I don't normally care that something is silly. I'll just take it for its silliness.
Mm-hmm.
But for some reason, I really, really had a problem with this one.
Hmm.
For no particular reason. I can't explain it, because I can watch Michael Jordan play basketball with Bugs Bunny and not have a problem with it. But
Space Jam.
Yeah, exactly. I can watch Brendan Fraser deal with the Looney Tunes and Back in Action.
There you go.
Unfortunately awful also. But, I can watch Brendan Fraser throw a 100-mile-an-hour fastball in the one movie I like with him, Albert Brooks in The Scout.
There you go.
But
have you ever seen the movie School Ties?
I hear he's really good. I hear that's where he became a sort of a star. He had a breakout role in that.
I absolutely fell in love with Brendan Fraser because of that film.
It was excellent.
It was so good. He was so good in it. It really showed his range. It was really an excellent film.
I maybe because I associate him with Pauly Shore from Encino Man. And
yeah.
I've had some bad experiences on the radio with Pauly Shore.
Oh, jeez. So you've had to interact with Pauly Shore on a couple of occasions?
Oh, he's awful. He's just a terrible human being.
Well, what's so bad about him?
He's a jerk.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's just plain and simple, huh?
Yeah.
Man,
so.
I'm telling you.
And maybe I'm taking it out, unfortunately, on poor Brendan Fraser.
Maybe Pauly Shore should have been cast in the role of Benny, and then we could just enjoy watching him get eaten by the bugs at the end. That'd be good.
Oh, my God. That poor actor.
Oh, my God.
Was that Kevin O'Connor? Was it Kevin O'Connor?
Yeah. In the scene in the Egyptologist office where Brendan Fraser beats the crap out of him, it got too rough.
He had to ice his nipples.
They had to ice his nipples.
Well, okay.
Yeah.
Also, maybe I have such an affinity for those original Universal monster movies, the original Frankensteins and Draculas and Creatures of the Black Lagoons and such, that and to me that one's more serious.
I think I'm going to be honest. I have not seen those movies since I was very small, like 10, 11, 12 age, it's been since I've seen the classic monster movies.
And there's some that are better than others. Creature from the Black Lagoon, to be honest, is kind of boring.
Right.
But
okay.
I just enjoyed that feel. And this isn't a monster movie. Like Rachel Weisz, I agree with her.
Yeah.
This is more of a Raiders of the Lost Ark type of movie.
It definitely has that feel. I was waiting for Harrison Ford to come out from the background.
Do you find, because it was made in 1999, do you find that this movie was a response to the fact that there was a lack of Indiana Jones movies out? I mean,
let's see, Raiders came out. When did Temple of Doom come?
Temple of Doom was, well, let's see, Raiders was early 80s.
Yeah.
Temple was late 80s. And then Crusade was.
Yeah, that's the one.
Hold on, let me go look at the franchise.
And I really love 8, maybe because I'm a fan of Raiders of the Lost Ark in those movies.
Lost Ark 81, Temple of Doom 84, Last Crusade 89.
Oh, wow. Okay. So even.
And then it had been 10 years, and then then The Mummy.
Right.
And then Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, which is the fourth one, was 2008.
All right. So what we're seeing here is probably this movie was influenced by the fact that there was a love for the Indiana Jones movies, and there wasn't an Indiana Jones movie to be had.
Right.
So maybe this was their way of kind of jumping in on that. Go ahead, Cher.
Stephen Sommers actually states that his biggest influences for this film were the Raiders of the Lost Ark movies and Jason and the Argonauts, believe it or not. He was looking for something, an over-the-top fantasy action feel, and he never intended it to be a horror movie.
I got to watch this in a better mood because it sure seems like something I should like. I'm serious.
Yeah. It might be the mood I woke up in today too, but I was laughing a lot yesterday while we were watching.
Yeah. I mean,
and now today I'm like, it was all right.
I know. That's why I'm like going, wait, it's like,
what a difference a day makes. I tell you, we should have podcast while we were watching it.
Well, according to the messages I got when, I was watching the movie yesterday.
Yes.
It said I was actually chatting with Sir Erick Avari.
Oh.
Yes.
That's right.
Yesterday,
you were.
I was
doing a little Facebook messaging.
Facebook messaging back and forth. Because
that's awesome.
With him coming in and me being one of the VIP liaisons, I'm double checking with all of our media guests to see if there's anything in particular food-wise or whatever they want. And he's been very forthcoming and just very nice in general, and like it's like, no, nothing he can really think of. He's got no dietary restrictions whatsoever. I'm like, okay, let me know if there's anything, and he's like, okay, I'll let you know if I do. And I'm like, I go, I must say I'm enjoying The Mummy again today because it's been a while since I've seen it. So didn't get anything back from him. Didn't get anything. Last night, 11:30, a message hits. He goes, you better, with the laughy face, the sunglass emoji, and the sticking your tongue out one. I'm just like, he's like, well, you better, type thing. So it's just, I'm like, you go and start talking about it. And then I'm like, I've gotten a couple emails from him directly instead of going through his agent. I'm just like, what a stand-up guy he is. I can't wait to meet him in person.
See, that's the thing. I mean, you probably take all of these actors off the set and just talk to them as people, and they're all really cool. I don't think any of them were, I don't think we're questioning them
as
people.
Not.
We're just seeing the characterizations right now. It's like, it's interesting.
But I don't want to get anywhere near him in a sword because he was taking down
swinging for the
mummies.
Cheap seats.
Yes.
His scene where he's going off against the zombies there, that was amazing.
Yeah.
That was great stuff.
Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh.
That was great stuff. Where do we want to take this one from here? We're going to take this conversation. I mean, it's we are not a book club. We never really ever talk about the story. We kind of more do a review, and then we move on.
Well, we can look at who was considered for the different roles. The
Were there other people?
The only person that was offered Evelyn was uh-huh. Rachel Weisz.
Okay.
However,
so they had her in mind mm-hmm. from the beginning.
Right. But Tom Cruise, Brad Pitt, Matt Damon, Ben Affleck, Chris O'Donnell, and Matthew McConaughey were considered for the role of Rick O'Connell.
Interesting.
Yep.
All right. This is definitely not a Ben Affleck movie.
Too brooding.
I can't see Matthew McConaughey doing it. He had the Clive Cussler stories, where he was like in Sahara. Oh, what was the character's name? I can't remember. Where they go, they're going to pull a Panama. Never mind. Dirk something or other. Anyway,
I'm doggy paddle on this.
I'm gonna. Who was else on that list?
Chris O'Donnell.
I see him as Robin from Batman. So
see Chris O'Donnell in the mid to late 90s. I think he might have been able to pull off
Rick?
The Rick character. I think so, because he hadn't been glued into a stereotype just yet. You know, he had Disney's Three Musketeers, so you had the young, dashing D'Artagnan, right? And mm-hmm. then he's had a couple of dramatic roles.
When was Scent of a Woman?
Scent of a Woman was early 90s.
Okay.
Early to mid-90s, I'm pretty sure of it. And that's one of my favorite movies ever, and he was just amazing in that.
Yeah, he was great.
92,
playing off of Al Pacino, of all things. I think Chris O'Donnell could have done a good Rick. Who else is on the list?
Bruce Campbell and Kurt Russell.
All right, with Bruce Campbell, you know that where that's going to go.
Bubba Hotep.
Yeah, you really.
Yeah. I would not
be
able.
The movie would become just a comedy at that point, because come on, Hail to the King, baby. It's all good. It's all good. But I don't think Bruce Campbell would have played the part.
And it
straight.
Says a couple lines down, Sylvester Stallone was offered the part.
Really?
Ooh. Yeah.
Sylvester Stallone.
That would have been good.
No, it wouldn't have.
It would have gone into really a Rambo have. Movie.
Yeah, seriously. It would have been all like, you would have had to bring out like 1,000 mummies. And because then he would have just been sitting there all going all Rambo with an RPG on him or something like that. It would have been insane.
Or a so, light machine gun.
Sherry and Chris, fantasy cast this movie for me.
I like the cast.
Okay.
You wouldn't make any adjustments whatsoever.
No, I love one of the reasons why I never saw the third one because I was so upset that they didn't have Rachel Weisz.
Right.
They couldn't wait for her to be done being pregnant. They couldn't let her have her baby. They had to put somebody else in, and that was one of the things that I love about this movie is her interactions with the other characters. She's my favorite character in the movie.
Hmm. When did The Rock join the Mummy ensemble?
He was there for two.
Scorpion King, the second movie.
And then they did another movie, The Scorpion King.
Which is the prequel.
Which technically is considered the third movie in the franchise. But
I'm saying it's not.
So that was separate.
It's separate. So, because it didn't have Brendan Fraser, so it's like not. It was mm-hmm. like beforehand.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
You know, you were talking about that first scene, that scene in the jail. I guess Brendan Fraser almost died.
Yes, when
during
he
the
was
hanging
hung.
Scene, he had to be. Rachel Weisz says he had to be revived.
Wow,
because he had stopped breathing.
So they really strangled him.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus, talk about suffering for your art.
And it's funny because, like yesterday, we watched the movie, and then. I always like to kind of go to like see if there's any extras or whatever on the DVD and mm-hmm. things like that. So I happened to be jumped over to the deleted scenes, and it's one of your trivia things because Rick has a bandage or something on his hand or whatever in the movie, but you never know what had happened because the deleted scene was taken out that several mummies break through the floor and attack them. But they quickly turn their attention to that chest. They're able to pry it out from underneath the statue and get doused by that acid happens earlier on in the movie. And they're like, oh. But then it says this scene explains why a hole in the floor suddenly appears between the shots in the movie. Because, like, all of a sudden there's a hole in the floor So there's some continuity errors because they took a scene out. So I thought that was kind of interesting.
Here's the problem with location shooting. To avoid dehydration in the scorching heat of the Sahara, the production's medical team created a drink that the cast and crew had to consume every 2 hours.
Ugh.
Sandstorms were daily inconveniences. Snakes, spiders, and scorpions were a major problem, with many crew members having to be airlifted out after being bitten. Now, right there, I'm never doing a desert shoot.
Nope.
Go ahead, Tyler.
Snakes. Why does it have to be snakes?
Okay, see, there you go. That's it.
See, everybody quotes Raiders of the
Lost Ark.
Who quotes The Mummy?
I know, seriously.
Actually, our gaming table does.
Our gaming table.
Oh, okay.
Hey, Benny, you're on the wrong side of the river.
Yeah.
Hey, O'Connell, we've got all the horses.
Hey, Benny, I'm on the wrong. You're on the wrong side of the river. Anyway,
that's the line that we quote.
Always gets quoted
the
at the table the every day, whether it's appropriate or not. That quote shows up. Yeah. How about you guys on the phone? Your favorite quote.
Well, that's up there. I do like Evie's drunken.
I'm not drunk.
Recitation about her being a librarian. I love that.
Now
I am a librarian.
here's a great little side note from that. At that moment in time, Ian was passing through the room, and he's become a big fan of the Noah Wiley vehicle, the Librarians.
I love the Librarians.
Okay.
Yeah.
So as soon as Evelyn very proudly proclaims herself to be a librarian, he spins around, he looks at the TV, he's like, wait a minute, is this a spinoff?
I know.
I love that kid.
He like whipped around.
Oh, I thought
he
was going to give himself whiplash. He was so excited. He's like, wait, I didn't know. It's the Librarians are this spinoff of The Mummy? And I'm like,
Well,
you know what? It could work.
It could work.
It could fit.
Yeah.
But that was so funny. I am a librarian. How about you, Chris? Favorite moment of the movie so far?
I honestly have no clue.
Okay. He's like, why is he putting me on the spot? Don't do that.
No, that's not it. I really, really enjoyed the movie.
Right.
And that's why, you know, revisiting it with a second and a third, I'm just like, but why? Because I liked the first one so much.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was kind of tied up and with a neat little bow at the end. If they had changed it just a little bit,
mm-hmm.
you know, keeping the same characters, doing something different, that would have been great. I would have appreciated that more, I think.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I really did like, what kind of freaked me out a lot was whenever he screamed, the way his mouth opened.
Oh, the way they would enhance it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. That I thought was amazing. Because that's really just creepy.
Yeah. It added a whole level of you know, like, ooh, you know, that kind of a thing. I don't know. I'm with you, though. I understand what you're saying.
And the fact that he played it so straight while everybody else was, you know, joking and having a good time, even though, you know, crazy things were going on.
Mm-hmm.
He was very straight.
What I really like about him, about the way Arnold Vosloo approached the role, was that there's a saying that every villain is the hero of his own story.
Mm-hmm.
And he really did approach it as that he was like, it was like he was in an entirely different movie. He was in his own movie, and
okay.
This was just a really changed Romeo and Juliet story, and he was the good guy, and everyone else was keeping him from this great love. And I love that about the way he played the character, because it made him more real. He just wasn't just some, oh, I'm just an evil guy. He actually had a purpose, and he had a reason for what he was doing,
mm-hmm.
and maybe it wasn't good for everybody else, but why was everybody getting in his way? Why didn't everybody just let him have this wonderful love?
It's good to see villains that have actual, like, depth to them, and, you know, not just the cackling in the corner going, ooh, I'm going to blow up the world. Why? Because I feel like it. You know, it's you make a valid point in the regard that, you know, he had a motivation, he had a purpose, you know, he was sticking to a plan because there was a goal that was in mind. And all of the side benefits of, oh, yeah, sure, I can rain down the 10 plagues of Egypt and I can do all this great stuff. That's all secondary. It's more of, I just want to get what I want and be left alone.
And that was probably, I know we're talking about the first movie, but from the second movie, the thing that, a huge spoiler for the second movie, in the end, where he begs her to save him, to help him, and she says no. And he just, that was it. That was the, he no longer had a purpose.
After everything he had gone through to get her into that spat, you know, and after everything he had gone
the
through to have
defeat,
her.
He played that wonderfully.
Yeah.
And all the emotion was conveyed
really
in his eyes.
Broken after that.
Yep. After everything, all the struggles, all the ups and downs, dying repeatedly, you know, being brought back, all the killing that he had to do, all of the stuff that he had to do to have her just go, no, I'm out of here. Yep.
Yep. That's why, so for the second movie, it was like I needed a couple of moments. And that, because he was such a real character as a villain, it was almost like I needed him to just have that moment, that realization that really this was all for nothing. And I think that brought it really around for me. And one of the reasons, and that's one of the reasons I really like the second Mummy, The Mummy Returns.
Okay.
Can I say, I think my computer is listening to us. I literally just logged into my Twitter account. Very top tweet is a New York Times article about Rachel Weisz.
Wow.
Wow.
I heard a rumor she's pregnant again.
That's what this article
is about.
Is that
a thing? Is that,
yeah.
Okay. Well, good to her. I mean, you know, Mrs. James Bond. Awesome.
So now she's going to be a mommy.
A mommy.
Oh, instead of a mummy.
Mommy, yeah.
Yes. Are you my mummy?
Oh, I love that episode.
Mummy.
Mummy, are you my mummy?
Oh, boy.
And we just dropped into Doctor Who because why not? I'm here. Last licks.
Well, if you're going to go that way, one of the things that Sherry had here up near the top was talking about costuming. Where was that?
Oh, one of the cloaks that was lent to them by a costuming company was actually created. It was actually made for Alec Guinness for the first Star Wars movie.
Nice. So it was an Obi-Wan Kenobi cloak.
Yep,
and it was just worn by a random extra.
That's phenomenal. I love it. That is a good throwback. All right, so we're not so on the fence. I mean, you got a good chunk of the panel. We love the movie. I did like the movie. I go back
You're
between like and love, like and love, and I'm just cranky this morning. That's probably what's lending into it. So Billy and I are gonna watch the movie again someday when we feel better, and We'll see. We'll go from there. Anybody got any last licks for this movie? Anything they want to talk about in particular?
I really enjoyed the special effects with the sand.
With the sand?
Yeah, I think they did. You know, and that's the thing, is like right around the late 90s is when you start seeing CGI being less cartoonish and
less obvious.
Yeah, less obvious.
Like, wow, they somehow got that to do that.
Yeah. And that's really, you know, they did a lot of really good work with that in this particular movie. I liked how he would spin and run away from the cat.
I don't know if it was in the notes, but she was telling me about how they had to deal with sandstorms daily and scorpions and snakes and spiders and all things like that. But when you actually see the sandstorms that they do in the movie. You know, that was amazing. I thought they were incredible. I've always had a thing for tornadoes, so seeing dust devils like that, amazing.
No, I just start laughing. During the scene where Imhotep is raising the sandstorms in the desert, the camera had to quickly pan up as the wind machines being used kept blowing Arnold Vosloo's cape up, exposing his backside. Damn it! Damn!
that's wonderful, because at least it's an equal opportunity movie for men and women.
Yeah,
there you go.
I missed that part.
That would have been awesome.
Originally, the concept for the Magi were that they were going to be covered in tattoos.
Yes.
Okay.
That's in the scene.
Stephen Summers took one look at Odette and went, he's too good looking to be covered in.
Too good looking. Too hot.
He is.
And I, for one, thank you, Stephen. Thank you from the bottom of my heart.
And I thank both of those actors for jumping over to NCIS, because I have seen them several times since The Mummy. I'm like, wait.
Yes. They were both Mossad officers on NCIS, and they were both
warlocks and Charmed.
On Charmed.
Yep.
They should be going
to
Criminal Minds.
They were warlocks on Charmed.
Tyler now says that they have to hop over to Criminal Minds. So
to save it?
No.
No.
No. Whenever somebody like that goes to Criminal Minds, it gets really friggin' creepy. Look at Will Wheaton.
Yeah.
or Kim Curry.
Oh, true.
I can't watch Tim Curry's episode.
Or, what's his face?
I don't know. What's his face?
Michael
Walker? What? Oh, Alan Tudyk?
Yeah, Alan Tudyk.
Wash.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, did not like him on Criminal Minds either.
Oh, I haven't seen that one. I'm behind. I'm behind.
Alan Tudyk shows you what he's capable of when he's not being goofy.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Oh, it wasn't Criminal Minds.
It wasn't Criminal Minds?
No, it was Law and Order.
SVU?
Special Victims, yes. Which tells you the type of character he played.
Right.
Mm. Well, when you look at that, look at Dollhouse. You know, his range is amazing.
Yep.
But that's something different.
Yep. Tyler's shaking his head no.
All right. So, not a bad movie.
No, I mean,
lasting impression.
It was tremendously fun.
Yes. It's a fun movie.
It's what it was intended to be. It wasn't intended to be a horror movie. It was intended to be an action fantasy.
Okay.
They even tested everything to make sure it wasn't too gory, and I think it was just for you, Tanya.
It says the effects team was told no gore when designing the look of the mummy.
Right.
Yep. I just can't get past the scare beetles.
Yeah.
And then going up the arm, and I'm like, ah!
Yeah, that freaks me out too. That was probably the thing that freaked me out the most was it going up the body. Yeah.
And the one that dug into the boot of the
warden.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was like, this is gonna end bad.
Yeah.
So, please, I as a DM. Please, no big time scarab beetles jumping out at me. Please.
Oh, I'm sorry, but that's no. I can't make that promise. That's not.
Please.
No.
Kill Evan for it.
You know, with that whole thing, he was so into showing the pain that he actually accidentally ripped off his own shorts.
Oh, God. The warden?
Which is hysterical.
Oh.
That's funny.
You know, I'm like, we can talk about the different parts and what makes it funny, what keeps us out, and things like that. And that's part of, like, the joy of watching a movie is talking about it with our friends.
There you go.
And fans.
And that's what we do here on this podcast. We talk about it with our friends and fans.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And the conversation shall continue. And one of these days, the next time we talk about The Mummy, it'll be the 1932 Boris Karloff, I'm pretty sure.
Oh, okay.
That's got to be a thing.
Is that kind of spooky, Billy?
It's more thriller.
Yeah, it is. Then let's go with Abbott and Costello and Meet the Mummy.
There you go.
So we're going to take a break and talk about
other things.
The other stuff that we have.
Yes. I need video of Chris and Sherry doing walking like an Egyptian now.
I was dancing to this Thursday afternoon at work.
Yes, you were. It's true.
We needed this at the beginning. Maybe that you guys would have been a little more perky.
Probably not.
Probably not. You need coffee?
No.
Oh.
I'm not going that far. Anyway,
we're back.
Yes, we are back. We have a huge event coming up in 40 days. By the time this drops, it's not going to be 40 days.
If I do what I'm supposed to do, like a good boy, and I follow the script, the event, talking about events is next.
I know. That's why I was leading you into it.
Do we have to put you in timeout? You're like cutting people off. You're jumping in. What's going on over there?
Well, you're kind of Debbie.
Do you
want to
host this show?
Sometimes, yes.
Well, you can't.
Too bad. Can I fire him?
For the Firefly reference.
Yes.
Thank you.
He made a Firefly reference.
He did.
I can't let you fire him.
See, there you go.
Oh, do you want to be the captain of the ship?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now I got to warn you.
I know you're going to step back at one of them.
I'm planning vacation time, and one of the weeks that I'm looking at is going to be a podcasting session week. So you're going to have to host the show. It's going to be a thing.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
When is that?
I'm not telling you.
Well, I hope it's not the one that we're talking about, the...
No, we'll probably be...
The panels and the events type thing, because I'm stepping back from that one, so...
It wouldn't be until later in the summer, early fall.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So I'm like, leading up to the show? Don't do this to me.
That's the one entitled, What Would Chris Do?
Yes.
I would love that. Oh. I would love to listen to that one after the fact. That'd be great.
You and I. We'll do What Would Chris Do?
All right, so the event list is short, it's sweet, but it's powerful, it's potent, it's amazing.
To the point.
The Flower City Comic-Con coming at you in 3D. June 9th and 10th at the Floriano Rochester Riverside Convention Center. You can find tickets online. You can also buy tickets at the door. They'll be a touch more expensive at the door. But beforehand, you can also, if you need to have that ticket in your hand, you can go to the following locations to buy tickets. First Print Comics, 13th Verse Comics, Blades for Life at Puff Palace, End Zone Collectibles, Rhino's Comics and Collectibles, Comic Book Heaven, All Heroes Comics, Comic Etc., Yankee Clipper, House of Cards, Hammer Girl Anime, and Wonderland Comics. All of those places will have FC3 tickets at their disposal for you to purchase. All right, moving on. Everyday heroes. Not all heroes wear capes. Who is your hero? Do you know a fireman, police officer, nurse, EMT, military personnel, teacher, or librarian? Who is your personal hero? If so, please let us know all about that person. We'll give them a shout out on the air. Please send your nominations to fc3monkeybusiness@gmail.com. Question of the week. Billy.
Yes.
Who do you think are the best dressed fictional characters, and what makes them stand out for you?
The obvious one is James Bond.
Okay.
Now, he's always wearing the tuxedo, and unless he's in his Speedo on the beach with Ursula Andress or something.
There you go.
But the one that I just...
The least dressed.
Yeah. Or the least dressed, yeah.
The one I like the look of, even though it isn't like classically well-dressed, Rorschach. With the trench coat, the hat.
From Watchmen.
Watchmen.
Yeah.
And the mask with the blotches on it, the chain. I love that look.
It's very classic noir.
Uh-huh.
That PI, the Dick Tracy and the Humphrey Bogart movies, that kind of a thing.
That's, so I'm going Rorschach for my weird one.
Sherry, coming at you in 3D. I like saying that these days.
You'll appreciate this one.
Tell me.
Love the look of the Eighth Doctor.
Okay. I'm in on that
love
one. Now,
him.
Is it his
love
original
him.
Costume?
Love the Victorian aesthetic of the waistcoat and the pocket watch and the frock coat. Mm-hmm. And, I just love the way he dresses. He is my favorite. That's my favorite Doctor's outfit.
How do you think about the outfit they changed him into when they modernized him up for the new series?
See, I saw that as kind of like a dirty diversion.
Okay.
And he still had that Victorian
the same aesthetic.
And I love them both. I love the fancy. I love the bedraggled. I've been through hell and back. Look, I really wish he had done more because I really think that he was just fantastic.
I see you and I share that opinion without question. The Eighth has always been kind of in the background as one of my favorites just because I liked the look. I liked the personality of Paul McGann. I did hear a couple of his Big Finish audios, so I could hear him do a little bit more of the character so you could get a feel of what the Eighth Doctor was more like. I prefer the updated outfit to the original. If I ever cosplayed, it would definitely be Eighth Doctor myself. So cool. Yeah, that's a good one. Chris, how about you? Who do you think is the best dressed fictional characters and what makes them stand out for you?
Oh, God. I don't even remember. We discussed this the other day, and I don't even remember who I said.
Well, you did bring up James Bond like Billy did.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Because he's such an obvious one.
Yeah. Do you want me to come back to you, brother?
Back to me, because there was somebody I said, and I can't remember who it was, that I thought was really interesting.
Tyler J. Metris V. I'm going to come to you now, Mr. Fuzzy Face over there. I'm going to ask you the question. Who do you think are the best dressed fictional characters, and what makes them stand out for you?
I would say the 10th Doctor.
Okay. Do you like the coat?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Now, is there something in particular you would have changed about the 10th?
No.
No, Tyler's playing it safe because he knows that there's like thousands of fangirls out there who would have his hide for making, oh, no, we should change the 10th thing. Okay. How about you, Tanya?
Oh, God.
We've got two doctors and a guy who's supposedly a Time Lord.
Okay, 10th, because I'm not always good with the numbers, is David Tennant.
Correct.
Okay.
Wibbly wobbly, timey wimey.
Yeah.
Stop.
Always remember, Tennant has 10 in his name, so it works out really well to remember.
There you go.
The best dressed fictional character.
You know, Mickey Mouse has those suspenders.
Oh, well, yeah.
They really, the braces do.
Donald doesn't wear pants, so that's good.
That's a hard question because there's a lot of characters that are like impeccably dressed and things like that.
Uh-huh.
You know what? Derek Morgan is pretty. You know, if I was going to do that, I would have to jump to Penelope Garcia from Criminal Minds.
Okay.
If I was going to.
Oh, love the way she dresses.
Yeah, so that is just. She embraces her inner like geekiness and nerdy, and she just doesn't give a flying whatever what everybody else.
Spreaker button, not a flying spreaker button.
Yes, no, like... I didn't say it, so therefore I'm not going to do that. So I think that and you know, I just...
kind of rockabilly '50s Betty Page type thing. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. And so I'm like it. That's just a really hard question to answer, but if I was going to do that, I definitely would have to go Penelope Garcia, or I would go back to just the outfits that you see on Charmed, just because that, even though they don't have
the Charmed
full-time
ones?
Jobs or whatever, but they seem to have like great clothes.
And the great
and
house
shoes.
In California.
Yes.
They live in this awesome Victorian house in California.
Game,
but
Well, it was Graham's house. Come on.
Oh, yeah, it's passed down through the family.
Yes.
Or Stuart Little, because it's so hard to put sneakers on a mouse.
Really, it is.
It is.
I'm going to give Chris a little bit more time. I've got two.
He's got it.
Oh, Chris got one? Okay, go ahead, Chris.
Yes. Actually, what we been discussing was actually updated costumes.
Okay.
Specifically, the one that came to mind was Captain America's.
Okay.
In the actual movie.
Uh-huh.
Because they made it functional.
Yeah.
And that's what they've done with a lot of the comic book characters when they've brought them on screen. You know, when you look at Arrow and the X-Men.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the comment about the blue and yellow spandex.
Yeah, exactly.
They wore actual costumes that were functional.
Right. And I do like seeing the evolution of Captain America throughout the movies, you know, right from the first one he's in all the way to Infinity War.
Yeah. So. I mean, they changed everything so it was functional in the real world.
Mm-hmm.
And that was how I took it, as best dressed, as opposed to, you know, who was most impeccably dressed.
Okay. I have two that I want to bring up, and they're both ensembles, okay? The first is the crew of the Nebuchadnezzar in Matrix when they're in the Matrix, because those outfits are just freaking badass. You know, and they're all dark, and they're well-dressed, they're impeccable, and except for the one, not Mouse. I'm trying to remember the woman who was in the white, because she was just this ultimate contrast to everybody else. That's that visual that struck me, and so there's
a movie that never should have had a sequel.
I agree with you on that one.
Which one?
Matrix. Should never have been more than just the one Matrix. They did everything they needed to do in the one.
I saw all the DVDs when I was throwing all the DVDs through my shelf looking for my copy of The Mummy. I saw all the Matrix. I saw all the Underworld. I'm just like, I saw all of the other copies, like, but
couldn't find your mummy.
I couldn't find my mummy.
But
you probably found the third one.
My other ensemble cast, and it's not so much best dressed, but most iconic dressed. They are the crew of a spaceship that has a license plate NCC-1701. It's iconic.
Yes.
Okay, the blue, red, the yellow. The original. You know, they've had better uniforms throughout the TV series and movies and whatnot. I mean, like, the Next Generation uniforms towards the end of the run when they have the black with the gray shoulders and the colored turtlenecks. I thought those were very distinctive. But nothing says this is classic science fiction for me than those original, you know, the original 60s, really. That's it. You know, the gold, the red, and the blue. So those are my picks.
Though I really love in the Deep Space Nine episode Trials and Tribulations.
Oh yeah.
When they were talking about where Bashir was confused that Sisko was wearing gold and just the change in colors.
Uh-huh.
And it was, oh no, they changed the colors back then. Command wore gold and engineering wore red, and then you just hear Jadzia's voice saying, and women wore less.
Yes. And then there she is in the miniskirt dress. That was a great scene from that episode. That whole episode was a wonderful tribute to the original series, I thought. But
that was a lot of fun.
But yeah, I mean, that's
we should not a book club those two episodes together.
Okay. That's a great idea as far as I'm concerned.
Give Billy advance warning.
Yes.
Yeah. Right.
We caught him off guard with Mummy. So who would just brainstorming right now, we all had our answers that we picked, but who would be a good somebody else?
For the Mummy?
No, for best dressed fictional characters.
Okay.
I don't know.
Huh?
Hmm.
Do you got any ideas there, listener?
Darth Vader.
Darth Vader is best dressed. Very impeccable. His armor's always shiny. If you are, dear listener, if you have a suggestion for that, then feel free to let us know. I think that'd be phenomenal to hear from you and see what you have to say about it. And then we will talk about your choices in one of our future podcast recordings. So,
The 11th Doctor.
The 11th, the bow ties are cool?
Yes.
Okay, so all of the doctors so far have been fairly well-dressed, except for six.
Dr. Seuss?
Yeah, Dr. Seuss. I don't know, he was good for a couple of, you know, nice sweaters. Not thinking of anything else, are we?
Firefly.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
They all have very functional costumes.
Mm-hmm.
I personally dress like Jane all the time and have for years. And it has nothing to do with that. I just like cargo pockets because I'm not carrying a purse.
No, it would be a knapsack. Isn't that what is in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, Drax hits oh God, Peter. I couldn't think of the name for a moment. Peter.
Well,
It's like he was just kind of scattering away into the ashes with me there.
Stop.
That was bad.
Bad.
All right. But yeah, Drax hits Peter. You know, you're bringing your purse. It's a knapsack.
Oh, there it is.
So. All right. So we're going to wrap this one up for the day and move on to something else. And that something else will probably be lunch and whatnot. So. There you have it. That's your monkey business. And yay! No, play this one. Play this one.
That's the wrong one. That's the wrong one.
Oh my
God. That's the wrong one. Here's the right one, Chris. The one you love so much.
Yay! Oh, wonderful.
It's been a while.
I know.
They're laughing at the other end.
I was kind of expecting it to be Benny Hill for a second.
So, monkey business. Mighty Monkey Corporation, Flower City Comic Con, June 9th and 10th. Find us on Facebook. Please wave to us there. Poke us, like us, love us, and support us on Patreon. And we will see you all, guys, very, very soon. Have a wonderful week. And I didn't escape the damn song.
How do we end the show again?
I don't know. Do we ever end the show?
No.
It just keeps going.